Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Jeanette, and I'm one of the first year's fellow, infectious disease fellow. Today, we will spend a little bit time and we will talk about infective endocarditis. One diagnosis that is long known and never to be forgotten. The learning objectives today will be to identify the signs and symptoms that may indicate presence of infective endocarditis, to list the common causative organisms and risk factors for infective endocarditis, to distinguish between antibacterial treatment for infective endocarditis and caveats unique to infective endocarditis drug regimens, and finally, to describe supportive therapies that may be indicated in treatment of this disease. I will start with a few vignettes. The first one is 32 years old lady presented with low grade fever for 21 days and sudden left-sided hemiparesis. She had a history of major abdominal surgery 3 days back, and she is diagnosed case of a ventricular septum defect with Eisenmenger syndrome. The second case is 42 years old lady presented with low grade fever for 21 days. She had a history of colonoscopy 31 days back and diagnosed with ulcerative colitis. She is also diagnosed of has diagnosis of aortic valvular disease. There is another 18 years old lady presented with low grade fever for 29 days. She had a history of tooth extraction 35 days ago, and she has also valvular heart disease. 24 years old man presented with fever and chills for 10 days, and he is intravenous drug abuser. On examination, we found apparent systolic murmur in precordium. And the question will be, what is the common between all of these cases? And maybe we can give example for many other. The answer is one, and this is infective endocarditis, despite the different settings and case scenarios. Infective endocarditis is a microbial infection of the endocardial surface of the heart and has been classified as acute or subacute chronic based on severity of clinical presentation and the progression of untreated disease. The characteristic lesion of vegetation is composed of a collection of platelets, fibrin, microorganisms, and inflammatory cells. It most commonly involves heart valves, but there are also cases and description with involvement of the site of the septal defect, Hardy tendine, or the mural endocardium. The risk factors for endocarditis could be separated into two big groups. We have infectious causes and we have non-infectious causes. The topic today will be focused mainly in the infectious causes. But just for the completion of the presentation, we always have to think that endocarditis can be secondary to acute rheumatic fever, Lieben-Sachs endocarditis, rheumatoid arthritis, Marantic endocarditis, or Loeffler endocarditis. From infectious standpoint, there are a few, maybe in group, risk factors for endocarditis. The first one, this is gram-positive bacteria that actually are the predominant group responsible for the disease. Among gram-negative bacteria, the HACCP group accounts about 5 to 10% of community-acquired infectious endocarditis as well. Risk factors for infective endocarditis could be cardiac and non-cardiac. From the cardiac, it's extremely important is the history of prior infectious endocarditis, presence of prosthetic valve or implanted device, congenital heart diseases, and valvular abnormalities. Non-cardiac causes could be IV drug abuse, indwelling IV lines, immunosuppression, recent dental or surgical procedures associated with bacteremia. From all of this non-cardiac, I would like to underline the first one. This is the IV drug abuse. And the reason why is because in the recent data that we have, cases of infectious endocarditis is going up in the last years. And one of the main reasons for that is increased IV drug abuse in the United States and as well all over the world. Here, there is a graphic that actually shows the trend between 2002 and 2016 for the cases with infectious endocarditis that are associated with drug abuse. I'm sorry. Just trying to minimize this one. Okay, and we see in the graphic that definitely if you go from 2002 to 2016 in the right side of the screen, we see the definitely increasing the case of the infectious endocarditis. We also see that if you compare the patients who are drug abuser, this is the red line, with the patients who are not drug abuser, definitely the infectious endocarditis trend is going up and it's significantly higher than the other. This is also one map of the United States, and it shows actually the trend of infectious endocarditis in drug abusers, and also the trend of the all hospitalizations with people with infectious endocarditis who have history of drug abuse. We see that actually the higher percent is the west part of the country. The trend of drug abuser with infectious endocarditis in the west part is up to 4.3%. And the trend of the hospitalization in the west part of the country is up to 7.4. But it's also high for the rest of the United States. What are the common causes of infective endocarditis? The most common are the oral streptococci. These are the streptococci viridans group, Streptococcus bovis, Staphylococcus, of course, Staphylococcus aureus, and the coagulus negative Staphylococci. Here we have to mention definitely enterococci and Enterobacteriaceae. From the fungal infection, the main interest that we will be focused will be the Candida endocarditis. The etiologic features of infective endocarditis in developed countries are changing, and it's a result of increasing longevity, new predisposition factors, and increase of the nosocomial cases. In the United States and Western Europe, the incidence of community-acquired native valve endocarditis in most recent studies is between 1.7 to 6.2 cases per 1,000 person per year. Like I said, the risk factors are associated with injection of drug use, poor dental hygiene, long-term hemodialysis, and diabetes mellitus. Among patients with HIV, infective endocarditis is usually associated with injection drug use or long-term indwelling intravenous catheters. Staphylococcus aureus is the most frequent pathogen in this group of patients. When you talk about the structural valve disease, mitral valve prolapse is now the most common cardiovascular diagnosis that is predisposing factor for patients to develop infective endocarditis. A little bit more epidemiology, between 7 and 25% of the cases of infective endocarditis in most, usually we have about 27 to 25 of the cases in the most developed countries. And although the mechanical heart valves are probably at higher risk for infections than bioprosthesis, during the first 3 months after surgery, actually later, the rates of infection for the two valve types convert, and they're almost similar in 5 years. There are a lot of studies and review of the literature shows a lot of data, but in 1985, actually, Calderwood and Associates reported the cumulative risk of prosthetic valve endocarditis about 3.1% at 12 months and 5.7% at 60 months after surgery. In more recent studies, the risk was approximately 1% at 12 months and 2% to 6 months. You see big difference, actually decline on the data nowadays compared with 1985 years ago. Cases with onset within 2 months after surgery are called early prosthetic valve endocarditis and are usually acquired in the hospital. This is some short information about the nosocomial infective endocarditis. That usually is between 7 to 29% of all cases of tertiary care hospitals. And usually it's related with the infected intravascular devices, half of the cases. And the rest are split between GI and urological procedures and surgical wound infections. We'll talk a little bit now about the microbiologic features of infective endocarditis. I already mentioned that gram-positive bacteria account for approximately 80% of the cases of native valve endocarditis. From them, Staphylococcus aureus is about 35 to 40%, Streptococci in 30 to 40%, Enterococci account about 10%, Coagulus negative staphylococci, a common cause of the prosthetic valve endocarditis, are uncommon in the native valve, except for some, like Staphylococcus luginensis, that actually which resembles with Staphylococcus aureus clinically. And Hasek species, fungi, polymicrobial infection, and rarely aerobic gram-negative bacilli usually are reported about 5% of all of the cases. This table is actually very nice because we can distinguish the etiology and the leading cause of infective endocarditis in native valve versus prosthetic. You see in the graph that usually the main reasons and etiology for native endocarditis are Streptococcus species and Staphylococcus aureus among all the ages. And in contrast, prosthetic valve endocarditis has a little bit different etiology. The main etiology agents are coagulus negative staphylococci, with exclusion of the late after 12 months after late endocarditis after procedure, 12 months after surgery. Then again, Streptococcus and Staphylococcus are the main reason for that. Because of the different portal of entry, the causative microorganisms are different and they vary clinically, depends on the type of the endocarditis. And this is again one summary to distinguish the etiology for the native valve endocarditis. I already mentioned viridans streptococci, staphylococci, Hasek organism, Streptococcus galloleticus, this is the previous known of Streptococcus bovis and enterococci. Health care associated native valve endocarditis, the main organism that we have to think always is Staph aureus, following the coagulus negative staphylococci and enterococci. When we talk about the prosthetic valve endocarditis, coagulus negative staphylococci are the main and they follow the rest of the microorganism. And at the end, infectious endocarditis in IV drug users, the main number one reason is Staphylococcus aureus, often it's MRSA. But we can also see cases of Pseudomonas, Candida, Bacillus, Corynebacterium. There are also cases of culture negative endocarditis, and the microorganisms that can be the reason for that are Coxiella burnetii, Bartonella species, Brucella, Legionella, Mycoplasma, and the rest that you see in the slide. Usually 15% of the cases, the etiology cannot be determined due to antimicrobial administration prior. Usually many often the reason for that is some previous antibiotic use. What about the pathogenesis of infective endocarditis? The presumed initial event is valvular endothelium or endocardium disruption. This injury exposes subendothelial collagen and other matrix molecules to which platelets and the fibrin adhere, and they form initially a thrombotic lesion that is sterile, and it's called sterile vegetation. Bacteria circulating in the blood then have good place to bind and colonize in this sterile vegetation. And in the absence of effective host response, bacteria replicate in situ, stimulating further platelet and fibrin deposition and form the infected vegetation that is the hallmark of infective endocarditis. We see here in the lower picture on the left side in black, this is actually bacteria that is surrounded by fibrin and within the vegetations. And there are also a lot of inflammatory cells that are showing with the white arrow. This is one more time, some summary of the pathogenesis. Definitely, we have to have some kind of endothelial dysfunction that predispose to microthrombi. And on the second level, we have bacterial proliferation, neutrophil and macrophage infiltration, and formation of the vegetation. This is one of the many pictures that we have for infective endocarditis in the vegetation. These are huge vegetations in the mitral valve that practically lead to disruption of the valve function. When we talk about the pathogenesis, I would like to make the connection between the vegetation and the possible mechanism responsible for the infectious and endocarditis presentations. What actually is vegetation? Vegetation is extremely formation with extremely high concentration of microorganisms. And this high bacterial density, the growing of vegetation, friability and fragmentation of vegetations are the main mechanism responsible for the infectious endocarditis presentation that is involving valvular destructions and paravalvular extension and heart failure, micro and macrovascular embolization, metastatic infection of target organs, and immunological phenomena like false positive rheumatoid factor, RPR, or ANCA. The clinical manifestation of the infectious endocarditis depends on the type of the microorganism, and usually we can have acute presentation, you can have subacute, or we have indolent infectious endocarditis. Usually for the acute, we always count staph infection or streptococci. Subacute endocarditis is related to the virulent streptococci, enterococci, and some coagulase negative staphylococci. And the indolent usually is for some not very common and microorganism like Bartonella and Coxiella barnetti. The clinical manifestation of infectious endocarditis is very broad. We can have a lot of constitutional symptoms with fever, weight loss, myalgia, arthralgia. But extremely important are also the cardiac symptoms, and the physical exam is extremely crucial, because in the physical exam we can have new heart murmur or worsening previous murmur. Many these are murmurs from the mitral or aortic insufficiency or tricuspid insufficiency. As a result of the valvular dysfunction, we have development of heart failure. Most of the time, this is systolic heart failure with very low ejection fraction. And we can have also perivalvular abscess complicated by intracardiac fistula, conduction abnormalities, and pericarditis as well. From all of these things that I mentioned, the fever and the heart murmur are the two signature features of infective endocarditis, and they present in approximately 90% and 75% of patients, respectively. What about the clinical manifestation and non-cardiac things that we can see in our patients? Actually, the hospital course in endocarditis patients can be complicated, and it can be complicated from stroke or some encephalopathy. It can be complicated for aseptic purulent meningitis, from intracranial hemorrhage due to rupture of mycotic aneurysm. Could be complicated as well from seizures. Actually, here Dr. Kumar mentioned initially that right now in the hospital we have cases of infective endocarditis, and some of these cases actually we have patients with definitely intracranial hemorrhage. One of the cases is mycotic prosthetic aortic valve endocarditis in young patient who is IV drug abuse. In summary, the risk of embolization can increase with the Staph aureus infective endocarditis. It's higher when the vegetation is more than 10 millimeters in diameter, or when the infection involves mitral valve mainly. We all know about some of the signs of infective endocarditis that are a result of immune complex deposition. And I put here picture of the rose spot in the retinas, splinter hemorrhage under the nail bed, Janeway lesions, and Osler nodes. We all are aware about them. Macroembolic or immunologic phenomena such as these that I mentioned are usually presenting about 5 to 10% of all of our patients. Some clinical manifestations in patients with IV drug abuse, we have usually involvement of the tricuspid valve, and we can have some symptoms that usually are not so prominent when we have left-sided endocarditis. The tricuspid valve involvement can be present with a cough. This patient can have some kind of pleuritic chest pain, and also we can see some nodular pulmonary infiltrates in the imaging studies. Healthcare associated infective endocarditis usually is related to the transvenous pacemakers or implantable defibrillators. And in these cases, we always have to assess the pocket of the infection. These patients usually they don't have so significant murmurs, but we can have some pulmonary symptoms that are related to the septic emboli. And at the end, prosthetic valve endocarditis usually happens within 60 days of the valve surgery, and typical symptoms may be masked by the other comorbidities associated with the recent surgery, conduction abnormalities, or heart failure. Diagnosis of infectious endocarditis is very strict. We have criteria that we have to meet to be sure that this is probable or definitive diagnosis. We have some non-specific lab findings like CRP, ESR, anemia, leukocytosis, but the main two that I would like to underline, these are the blood cultures and the echocardiogram. This is the modified Dukes criteria for infective endocarditis. We all know these criteria. We have majors and we have minor criteria. From the major criteria, the blood culture positivity is the main one, and the second is the evidence of endocardial involvement. That includes positive echocardiogram or new valvular regurgitation in the echo. The blood cultures, we have to have two separate blood cultures with a typical microorganism consistent with infective endocarditis. For this typical microorganism, we count Staph aureus, Staph viridans group, Hase group, for the positive blood cultures, we have to have positivity blood cultures for organisms that are typically cause of infective endocarditis. We have to have more positive cultures from samples with at least 12 hours apart. Or organisms that are more commonly skin contaminant, we need a three or more, four separate blood cultures that should be positive, and they should be at least 1 hour apart. When we talk about Coxiella burnetii, one single positive culture is enough, with IgG antibody titer more than 1 to 800. We have five minor criteria that includes the fever, the immunological phenomena, vascular phenomena, predisposition, these are the heart condition, IV drug users, and also microbiologic evidence, positive blood cultures that don't meet the main criteria. The definitive diagnosis of infectious endocarditis, we have pathological criteria that are histologic evidence of acute endocarditis, vegetation or intracardiac abscess, or microorganism demonstrated on the culture or histology of vegetation or intracardiac abscess. To put the diagnosis, we need to have two major or one major and three minor or five minor criteria. For possible infective endocarditis, we need one major and one minor or three minor criteria. As in summary, the modified Duke criteria, which are based on the findings on physical examination, echocardiography, microbiologic studies, and computer CT or MRI of the target organs, are sensitive and specific for the clinical diagnosis of infective endocarditis. The blood cultures are the most important microbiologic tests for the diagnosis and treatment of this disease. and they fulfill a major DUC criterion. Approximately 90 to 95% of the cases of native valve endocarditis are blood culture positive. Three separate sets of blood cultures drawn 30 minutes apart are recommended before the initiation of the antibiotics. Blood cultures negative cases are most caused by recent administration of antimicrobial agents or by organisms that grow poorly or not at all in the standard blood culture media. And in this group of microorganisms, we count Bartonella, Coxiella, Legionella, and some other. These are the, some of the main causes of the diagnosis of cultural negative endocarditis. There are specific clinical and epidemiologic clue that we have to consider, and they can help us to think about the possible cause of endocarditis from all of these microorganisms. And like we see for many of them, we have available serological tests as well as some ribosomal RNA and PCR assay. Another one thing that we always talk about when we have people with infective endocarditis is the echocardiography. This is nice summary of algorithm when we have suspected endocarditis, how to proceed and when to get echo. But if I can summarize for the purpose of our presentations, we always start with transthoracic echo. Transesophageal echo has higher sensitivity for transthoracic. In all cases that we have high suspicion of infective endocarditis just because of this higher sensitivity, we always prefer to proceed with transesophageal echo, even if the transthoracic is negative. And I think it's the main message to all of us in the way that we do the echo and stepwise approach. These are pictures of the involvement of the mitral and aortic valve from vegetations. Pretty much systemic diagram of the vegetations. I already mentioned about the difference between transthoracic and transesophageal echo. Both of them are high sensitivity test, but the transesophageal has higher sensitivity for that, usually in the test of choice when we really want to rule out infective endocarditis. A little bit further of the infectious disease part of the lecture, but I think it's nice for us to have some kind of visual idea about the vegetations and the echo studies that we do. Here, for example, we see one big vegetation at the mitral valve. This is echo parasternal longitudinal axis. This is a vegetation that actually involve the anterior mitral valve leaflet. And actually, on this picture below, we see the associate mitral regurgitation that can develop the symptoms of heart failure. This is another one picture. This time we have aortic valve endocarditis that many times can lead this big type of vegetation to severe aortic stenosis. And very often these patients can present also with chest pain and some kind of stenocardial symptoms. This is another one picture of the transesophageal echo and the aortic valve with big vegetation. Here I put together the two images study, transthoracic and transesophageal, and we see that definitely the picture and the quality and assessment of the vegetation with transesophageal echo is much better. And this is extremely important for patients who have poor acoustic window, and sometimes it's very, very difficult to assess. These actually are pictures from one patient, the same patient, and we see the big difference between two modalities. Another one, tricuspid endocarditis. This is a picture from patients who is with tricuspid regurg, severe tricuspid regurgitation because of the IV drug abuse and a very severe infective endocarditis. Now we'll go a little bit to talk about the main principles of treatment of the infective endocarditis. I will start first with the basic rules. And number one is the ability, when we talk about treatment, which are the principles that we lay on? This is the ability of the regimen to kill the pathogen. This is the administration of prolonged course of therapy, weeks rather days. This is the intensive dosing to ensure adequate drug exposure and, of course, the source control. For patients with aspectic infective endocarditis who present without acute symptoms, empiric therapy is not always necessary and can be deferred until blood culture resulted and they're available. For acutely ill patients, however, with signs and symptoms strongly suggestive infective endocarditis, empiric therapy may be necessary, and such empiric therapy should be administered only after the at least two, sometimes we prefer actually three sets of blood cultures, have been obtained from separate sites over the 30 to 60 minutes. The choice of empiric treatment take into consideration the most likely pathogen, and in general, the empiric treatment should cover staphylococci, MRSA, and MSSA, streptococci, and enterococci, as these are the most common macroorganisms. Vancomycin plus ceftriaxone is a reasonable choice for empiric treatment to cover likely pathogens while cultures are pending in patients with native valve endocarditis. For susceptible strains, beta-lactams antibiotics are the cornerstone of definitive therapy. Antistaphylococcal penicillins like oxacillin, nafcillin, these are a drug of choice when we talk about staph aureus, that is MSSA. Cefazolin is a reasonable alternative for patients with MSSA who cannot receive penicillin without adverse effects. Going further, daptomycin or vancomycin monotherapy is recommended for treatment of native valve infective endocarditis caused from MRSA, staph aureus. Daptomycin has been recommended for endocarditis caused by staph aureus with vancomycin MIC more or equal to. Combination therapy is recommended for all enterococcal infective endocarditis, and this is something that always we have to have in consideration. Enterococci require the synergic activity of the cell wall agent and aminoglycoside for killing. If the ampicillin and gentamicin combination is used, the efficacy of combination therapy for 2 weeks, followed by ampicillin alone for 4 to 6 weeks, actually, may be like that of standard combination regimen for 4 to 6 weeks and is less toxic. Enterococci must be tested for high level resistance to streptomycin and gentamicin. If such resistance is detected, the cell wall active agent should be given alone for a period of time between 8 and 12 weeks. Or for Enterococcus faecalis, we can give high-dose ampicillin plus ceftriaxone as well. If treatment fails or isolate is resistant, surgical therapy usually is advised. Aminoglycosides can be discontinued if toxicity develops between the second and the third weeks of treatment. And all patients who have vancomycin or aminoglycoside in their therapy, they should be followed with drug level. I try to make a few slides now with summary of the treatment of the endocarditis, because actually at the end of the presentation, I have the guidelines and they're very busy slide. So I think it will be very helpful for the purpose of our presentation, the next few slides. First, I will talk about the native valve endocarditis. And we see that we have three main groups of cause. It is the staphylococcus, it's the viridin group streptococci, and enterococci. When you have native valve endocarditis, and the reason is staphylococci, we can distinguish between MSSA and MRSA. Treatment of choice for MSSA is oxacillin, nafcillin, cefazolin or vancomycin if we have penicillin allergy. When we have MRSA, the treatment of choice is vancomycin and the duration of treatment is 6 weeks. When we have native valve endocarditis caused by streptococci group D, we usually treat with penicillin or ceftriaxone plus gentamicin or vancomycin if we have penicillin allergy. and the duration of treatment as per guidelines is between 4 and 6 weeks. And lastly, when we talk about native endocarditis caused by enterococci, mainly Enterococcus faecium or Enterococcus faecalis, we have a combination ampicillin or penicillin G plus gentamicin. If we have resistant to gentamicin, we can go to ampicillin plus ceftriaxone. If we have resistant to ampicillin or penicillin, then you can go to vancomycin plus gentamicin. And if you have resistance to all ampicillin, penicillin, and genta, the treatment will be linezolid or daptomycin. So practically, we always have to remember enterococci endocarditis, enterococcus endocarditis, we have combination therapy, and the main therapy is ampicillin and penicillin plus gentamicin. The rest variations depends on the resistance, and I already mentioned them. And the duration of the treatment is usually equal or more often of 6 weeks. When you have prosthetic valve endocarditis, again, the main cause of that, staphylococci, streptococci, and then enterococci. Interesting and very important is to remember that when you have prosthetic valve endocarditis and it's caused by MSSA or MRSA, we have combination therapy. So vancomycin by itself or oxacillin or nafcillin, they're not enough. We have to combine with rifampin and gentamicin. The duration usually is more than 6 weeks, and usually we need at least 2 weeks of gentamicin. Regarding streptococci prosthetic valve endocarditis, it's similar to the native one. We have penicillin or ceftriaxone plus gentamicin or vancomycin when we have allergy to penicillin. The duration is 6 weeks. And enterococci infective endocarditis combination, no big difference from the native one. Again, depends on the resistance. We have some alternative regimens, but the main one remain ampicillin or penicillin G plus gentamicin, and the duration is more than 6 weeks. The native and prosthetic infective endocarditis due to Hasek microorganism, we have treatment. It's usually monotherapy with ceftriaxone, ampicillin, or ciprofloxacin, and the recommended duration is usually 4 weeks. Regarding culture negative infective endocarditis, we have native valve versus prosthetic valve. When we talk about the native valve endocarditis and we have acute clinical symptoms, usually the treatment for culture negative includes vancomycin and cefepime. If the clinical symptoms are subacute, then we have recommendation for vancomycin plus ampicillin sulbactam. For prosthetic valve endocarditis in people with culture negative one, everything depends on the time of the surgery. Within a year from the valve surgery, the recommendation is vancomycin plus rifampin plus gentamicin plus cefepime. It's quadruple therapy. If the surgery is more than a year ago, we can just go to vancomycin and ceftriaxone. And usually the duration of treatment for culture negative infective endocarditis is more than 6 weeks. Here, there is actually one interesting article in New England Journal of Medicine. So far, we're talking about a lot of different type of regimens, and all of the antibiotics are IV. But there is some investigation and thoughts about possible and suitable patients that actually can be treated at least part of the time for infective endocarditis with oral medications. And the point of this article is that the transition to oral step-down regimen after initial intravenous course of therapy may be actually considered in selective patients. This is the famous POET trial that actually determined the oral administered antibiotics versus intravenous. This is a study that is non-inferior. It's including national all Danish heart centers. and the publication was 2019 in New England Journal of Medicine. In the study, there are people with left side, only people with inclusion criteria was people with left-sided endocarditis caused by streptococci, enterococci, staphylococci, and coagulase negative staphylococci. Usually, to participate, we had to have at least 10 days IV antibiotic, and after that, the people were split in two groups. Some of them received, I will show here the graph, first 8 days IV antibiotic, and after that, some of the patients received oral antibiotic, some of them received intravenous antibiotic. And primary endpoints were all cause of mortality, unplanned cardiac surgery, embolic events, and relapse of bacteremia with the primary pathogen. What is interesting actually that the study found out, in red we see the intravenous treatment, with blue the oral treatment. Actually, they found that in the patient with endocarditis in the left side of the heart, who were in stable conditions, changing to oral antibiotic treatment was non-inferior to continued intravenous antibiotic treatment. And this is actually important before to go further, because if you take a pragmatic for the conclusion from this trial, if we are really able to switch some of our patients to oral medications, it will definitely decrease the length of stay and the use of the IV antibiotics. And definitely we need more studies for further evaluation, but definitely POET clinical trial is one cornerstone that put base for many further investigation in this direction. Removal of the cardiac devices. This is another one thing that we have to consider when we have infective endocarditis, and especially when we have lead vegetation of the pacemakers or some kind of infection of the devices. Pretty much high-grade bacteremia with coagulase-negative staphylococci. This is reason to remove the device. The positive blood cultures with candida and staph aureus, always we have to consider to remove the device. I should start from there, actually. If you have some kind of pocket infection, this is another one reason that we have to think to remove the pacemaker or any other device that is in the heart. Indications for the cardiac surgery, they are a little bit different from the left and right side endocarditis, acute heart failure, fungal endocarditis, high-grade blocks, bacteremia that is more than 5 days despite the adequate antibiotic treatment, severe valvular regurgitations, and mobile vegetations more than 10 millimeters. Emboli despite antibiotic treatment. All of these are reasons to consider cardiac surgery. In the right side, tricuspid, severe tricuspid regurgitation, right heart failure is usually one of the main reasons to consider surgery. But we also can think about surgery for patients with recurrent pulmonary embolism, with persistent infections, or very big tricuspid vegetations, usually more than 20 millimeters. This is a study that shows the outcomes of surgery from infective endocarditis. This is a single center experience study for with 1,800 patients. And we see the Kaplan-Meier survival curves that is showing the difference in the long-term survival based on the valve involvement. We see that isolated aortic valve replacement is associated with the best long-term survival. The aortic valve is with the blue. Key points: early surgery for uncontrolled infection, congestive heart failure caused by valvular dysfunction, or prevention of central nervous system embolization is associated with improved outcomes. Two meta-analyses show that the early surgery, as compared with the conventional therapy, was associated with 40 to 60% reduction of the death from any cases. However, how best to identify the patients who are the most likely to benefit from early valve surgery, it still remains unclear. Cardiac conditions that require prophylaxis, as per the recent guidelines, this includes prosthetic heart valve, previous infectious endocarditis, congenital heart disease, and cardiac transplantation to residual valvulopathy. And we see actually the level of recommendation, the class of recommendation on the left side of the screen. Procedures requiring infectious endocarditis prophylaxis, as per the RAS guidelines, include all dental procedures with manipulation of the gingival tissue, perforation of the mucosa or peripheral region of the feet. It also includes procedures involving surgery in the respiratory mucosa, bronchoscopy or tonsillectomy, and procedures of infected skin, skin structure or musculoskeletal tissue. This is the recommendation for antibiotic treatment, antibiotic prophylaxis for the conditions. In summary, management of infective endocarditis includes prompt diagnosis and institution of effective antimicrobial therapy, management of any incidental antithrombotic therapy, assessment of need for removal of any infected implanted devices or antiventricular access, identification of patients with indications for valve surgery, follow-up and prevention of recurrent endocarditis. Patients with left-sided native valve endocarditis frequently require early valve surgery due to the presence of one or more complications. Early surgery for prosthetic valve endocarditis is indicated for infective endocarditis complications similar to native valve endocarditis. It includes heart failure due to prosthetic valve dysfunction, paravalvular regurgitation or intracardiac fistula, annual abscess, or difficult to treat pathogen or persistent infection. When early surgery is indicated, it should not be delayed except for patients with major cerebrovascular complications, such as hemorrhagic stroke, or those with high operative or poor long-term prognosis due to other medical conditions. Patients with a history of infective endocarditis have a high risk of recurrent endocarditis in the future, and measures to reduce this risk, such as good dental hygiene, and antimicrobial prophylaxis should be undertaken. The key points that I would like to underline are the next one. Infective endocarditis is systemic life-threatening disease, mainly affecting patients with heart valve disease, prosthetic valves, intracardiac devices, or IV drug abusers. Clinical findings, echocardiography, and the blood cultures are the cornerstones of infective endocarditis diagnosis, and serological tests and PCRs may be useful when we talk about cultural negative patients. Transesophageal echocardiography is recommended in all patients with suspected or confirmed infective endocarditis. When heart failure or large vegetations more than 10 millimeters are present, early surgery is recommended and it's associated with improved long-term clinical outcomes. And finally, the antibiotic prophylaxis solely to prevent infective endocarditis is not longer recommended for persons at risk for infective endocarditis. What about some future perspectives? I did some reading about the recent study. And I think that the future perspective underlined below actually deserves to think about. I would like to mention, share my thoughts about the routine brain MRI that has been recommended to detect silent CNS emboli in patients who are candidates for valvular surgery. Although whether this improves the outcome is still unknown, and maybe we will need more further investigation in this area. Also, the data from the randomized controlled trials to inform the benefits or risk for oral antimicrobial therapy for infective endocarditis are still limited. Only 20% of the patients who underwent screening were enrolled, and a few had staph aureus infection. So we mentioned already about the POET trial, but I definitely think that additional data is definitely needed to clarify the safety and efficacy of this approach of oral antibiotic therapy in variety of clinical settings. And at the end, most guidelines recommend delaying valve surgery for at least 4 weeks in patients with large embolic CNS lesion or intracranial hemorrhage. However, earlier surgery may be safely performed in selected patients despite these conditions. And I believe that the future guidelines also will be focused in this direction as well. These are my references.